वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। हरे कृष्ण। वेलकम टू अवर वीकली इवनिंग सेशंस, वीकेंड सेशंस ऑन अवर डिस्कशंस ऑन श्रीमद् भागवतम। एंड टुडे आई विल बी डिस्क्राइबिंग द पास्ट टाइम ऑफ कृष्णा एंड सुदामा दैट इज स्पोकन बाय सुखदेव गोस्वामी इन द 10th कैंट ऑफ श्रीमद् भागवतम, चैप्टर्स नंबर 80 एंड 81। सो सुखदेव गोस्वामी हैज बीन नरेटिंग सो मेनी पास्ट टाइम्स ऑफ the Lord in the 10th canto, and at one point he elaborately describes the pastimes of Balaramji, and after concluding certain pastimes of Balaramji's pilgrimage and how he killed Ramaharshan Sutta and all, Parikshit Maharaj becomes very eager to know more of Krishna's pastimes. So in the 10th canto, 80th chapter, we see in the beginning few shlokas, beginning four shlokas, Parikshit Maharaj becomes extremely eager to know Krishna's pastimes. So his eagerness is expressed in these few verses. So Parikshit Maharaj says, I am reading from 10th canto of Bhagavatam, 80th chapter. Parikshit says, Bhagavan yani chanyani mukundasya mahatmanaham वीर्याण्यनंत वीर्यस्य श्रोतुम इच्छामि हे प्रभु। भगवान यानि च अन्यानि मुकुंदस्य महात्मनः। माय डियर सुखदेव गोस्वामी, प्लीज डिस्क्राइब द अदर पास्ट टाइम्स ऑफ लॉर्ड कृष्ण, एंड ही इज मुकुंद, ही इज महात्मना, ही इज द ग्रेटेस्ट पर्सनालिटी, ही इज द गिवर ऑफ लिबरेशन। आई वांट टू नो मोर ऑफ हिज पास्ट टाइम्स। And he says, Viryani Ananta Viryasya, the Lord is Ananta Virya, means he has unlimited energy. And I want to know his powerful pastimes that he enacts with his unlimited spiritual energies. And he says, Shrotum Ichhami He Prabhu, I am very eager to hear. So this eagerness to hear the pastimes of Krishna is one of the foremost qualities of a sincere devotee of the Lord. A devotee is one who is always very eager to hear the pastimes of Krishna, and such kind of spiritual hearing elevates one's consciousness and brings one closer to Krishna. When we love someone, it's natural that we want to hear about that person. So here Parikshit developed so much love for Krishna, naturally he wanted to hear about Krishna from the greatest of all devotees of Krishna, that is Sukadeva Goswami. So he says that कोनुश्रुत्वा सकृत ब्रह्मन् उत्तम श्लोक सत्कथाः विरमेत विशेषज्ञो विषन्न काम मार्गिणैः। सो परीक्षित महाराज सेज दैट हु विल नॉट टेक इंटरेस्ट इन हियरिंग अबाउट कृष्ण, वन हु अंडरस्टैंड्स द एसेंस ऑफ द प्रोसेस ऑफ भक्ति योग, वन हु इज डिवाइड ऑफ एनी अटैचमेंट फॉर सेंस ग्रेटिफिकेशन, एंड वन हु इज डिवाइड ऑफ एनी मटीरियल डिजायर्स। So such people can naturally have inclination to hear about Krishna. Nivritta tarshay upagiyamana bhavoshadhat shrotra manobhiramat ka uttama shloka gunanuvadat puman virajyate vina pashubhanat. So those who are done with this material enjoyment, those who have absolutely no interest to enjoy in a material plane, naturally have a sincere desire to hear about the pastimes of the Lord. So Sukadeva Goswami is being urged so fervently by Parikshit Maharaj to describe more of Krishna's pastimes in this way. And further, however, Parikshit Maharaj expressed his eagerness to hear more, that definitely he said, I want to hear more of the pastimes of Krishna. But like bhakti is not just engaging our ears in Krishna's service. Parikshit Maharaj in the next two shlokas, he says that bhakti includes engaging our tongue in glorifying Krishna, engaging our eyes in seeing the deity form of Krishna, engaging our hands in rendering various services to Krishna, engaging our legs in walking to Krishna's temple. Like that, in two shlokas, Parikshit Maharaj describes how a sincere devotee engages all his senses in Krishna service. That's the theme of the next two shlokas. Let's try to recite them. Savagyaya tasya gunan grinite karau cha tat karma karau manascha smaredvasantam sthirajangameshu srunoti tat punya kathah sakarna. So savagyaya tasya guna grinite. So the perfection of one's tongue is to glorify Krishna's pastimes. Even Suta Goswami episode in the first canto of Bhagavatam that describes that. Very interesting. It says that bile bato rukrama vikramanye nashrinvatah karna pute narasya. If one does not engage one's tongue in glorifying Krishna, that is like frog's tongue. So what does a frog do with its tongue? So especially in the monsoon, frog makes some sound, special sound that attracts the snake. And snake will come and swallow the frog. Okay. So similarly, if one is not engaging one's power of speech in Krishna's glorification, his tongue is compared with frog's tongue. And if one is not hearing Krishna katha through one's ears, the ears are compared to snake holes, right? So whatever is going into the ears is like snakes only, right? So in this way, those who are not engaging one's senses in Krishna service are criticized in Srimad Bhagavatam. And those who are engaging one's senses in Krishna service are glorified in Srimad Bhagavatam. Such people have great opportunity to connect with Krishna. So Parikshit further says, one has to use one's mind in remembering Krishna. One has to use one's ears in hearing about Krishna. One has to use one's hands in rendering various services to Krishna. Even in Mukundamala Stotra, Kulashekhar Alwar also says, he says, Jihve kirtaya keshavam muraripum cheto bhaja shridharam pani dvandva samarchaya chuta katha shrotra dvayatvam shrunam krishnam lokaya lochana dvaya harer gachhanghar yugmalayam jighra ghrana mukunda pada tulasim murdhanna madhokshajam. Jihve kirtaya keshavam, use your tongue to glorify Lord Keshava. Jihive kirtaya keshavam muraripum. Muraripum cheto bhaja. With your chetana, with your mind or consciousness, you worship Lord Lord Sridhara. Pani dvandva samarchaya chuta katha. With your two hands, samarchaya, you perfectly worship the Lord with all the paraphernalia. Shrotra dvayatvam shrunu. So with your two ears, you hear achyuta katha, you hear Krishna katha. Krishnam lokaya lochana dvaya harer, with your two eyes you see the beautiful deity form of Krishna. Gachhanghari yugmalayam, with your two hands you walk to Krishna's temple. Jighra ghrana mukunda pada tulasim, with your nostrils you smell the fragrance of tulasi offered to his lotus feet. Murdhanna madhokshajam, with your head bowed down in front of Krishna. So like that, Bhagavatam and other scriptures also are filled with recommendations of engaging our senses in Krishna service. Simple. So even in Ambarish Maharaj's episode in the ninth canto of Bhagavatam, we see Savai Manaha Krishna Padaravindayor Vachamsi Vaikuntha Gunanu Varnane. So Ambarish Maharaj has engaged his mind in Krishna service, in Krishna's thoughts. And Karau Harer Manjara Mandira Marjanadishu, he engaged his hands in cleaning the temples of Krishna. Right. So in this way, Ambarish Maharaj also engaged all his senses in Krishna's service. Right. Only when our senses are utilized in Krishna's seva, these senses are worth calling senses. Otherwise, they are dead. They are sleeping. They are said to be sleeping. So there is another shloka. Yat Krishna pranipata dhuli dhavalam tadvarshma tadvaishiram tenetre tamasojhite suruchire yabhyam harir drishyate sabuddher vimalendu shankha dhavala yamadhavadhyayini sajihvamrita varshini pratipadam yastavti narayanam. Yat Krishna pranipata dhuli dhavalam tadvarshma tadvaishiraha, that shira, that head that becomes whitened by offering obeisances to Krishna is the best head. Why head becomes white? Because when someone offers obeisances to Krishna's lotus feet, the dust from Krishna's lotus feet will touch one's head and the head becomes whitened. So that head is the best head. Yet Krishna Pranipata Dhuli Dhavalam. Dhuli is best. Dhavalam is white. Yet Krishna Pranipata Dhuli Dhavalam Tadvarshma Tadvaishira. Tenetre tamasojhite surjire. Yabhyam harir drishyate. Those netras, those eyes that see the beautiful, auspicious form of Krishna, they actually transcend the darkness of material existence. And they transcend the ignorance in this material world. So, because when we see, when we expose ourselves to the merciful glances coming from Krishna, the thick gloom of darkness within our hearts is completely vanquished. Te netreya tamaso jhite surucire yabhyam harir drishyate sa buddhir vimalendu shankha dhavala yamadhavadhyayini sa buddhir. Buddhi means our intelligence. Vimalendu shankha dhavala, you know, vimala indu, you know what is indu? Indu is moon, but moon has some spots. That's why the shloka says vimalendu means spotless moon. So white, okay, pure white. Vimalendu shankha dhavala. How spotlessly white is this moon? Like shankha. We see a conch shell that we blow before aarti. That is so pure white, right? Vimalendu shankha dhavala. Dhavala means white color. So that buddhi is spotless and it has absolutely no contamination. It is so clean and clear when it is engaged in contemplating on Madhava. Yamadhavadhyayini. When you do dhyana of Madhava with your intelligence, then the intelligence is said to be pure. Otherwise, intelligence is contaminated. So, Sajihvamruta Varshini Pratipadam Yastauti Narayanam. Sajihva Amruta Varshini. That jihva means that tongue which is constantly showering nectar. Amruta Varshini Pratipadam. In every word, a devotee's tongue showers nectar. What is that nectar? That nectar is the glorification of Krishna. Sajihvamruta Varshini Pratipadam Yastauti Narayanam. When you are doing stuti of Narayana, when you are glorifying Lord Narayana, then the tongue which is glorifying Narayana is said to be the best tongue, and it's said to be raining nectar, right? So Parikshit Maharaj is definitely showing so much of eagerness to hear Krishna Katha, but he also says that bhakti is not just engaging one's ears in Krishna Katha. Bhakti is also engaging all our senses in Krishna's service. So I hope this is very clear. So actually, Sudama pastime in the 10th canto of Bhagavatam begins with such a sweet prelude of a description of Parikshit Maharaj's eagerness to hear Krishna's pastimes. So we covered the first four shlokas. So basically, now I will be going through this pastime little in great detail, just like in Kunti Maharani's prayers also we went through the prayers in great detail. Like every shloka is touched upon. Of course, there is no end to discussing each of those prayers, but we touched every prayer and discussed for a few minutes at least. So this also we'll try to see as many shlokas as possible. So after hearing Parikshit Maharaj's eagerness to hear about Sudama pastime, our Sukadeva Goswami begins to describe. So Sukadeva Goswami also becomes so eager to describe. So when the hearer, when the person who is hearing Krishna Katha is very enthusiastic, excited, then the speaker also becomes very enthusiastic to describe the Lord. So it's not that the speaker, we see from Srimad Bhagavatam, throughout Bhagavatam, there are so many speaker-hearer pairs. One pair is Suta Goswami is speaking and the Naimisharanya sages are hearing. Second pair, Narada Muni is speaking, Vyasadeva is hearing. Third pair, Sukadeva Goswami is speaking, Parikshit Maharaj is hearing. And within that, there are multiple pairs. Maitreya Muni is speaking, Vidura is hearing. Narada Muni is speaking, Yudhishthira Maharaj is hearing. Like that, Bhagavatam is just a series of conversations or loops of conversations between sincere speakers and sincere hearers. Actually, what is the qualification of a hearer of Bhagavatam? And what is the qualification of a speaker of Bhagavatam? That is described in the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Tanno bhavan vai bhagavat pradhano mahattamaikanta parayanasya harerudaram charitam vishuddham susrushatam no vitanotu vidvan. Tanno bhavan vai bhagavat pradhano. All the sages of Naimisharanya are describing Suta Goswami's qualification to speak Bhagavatam. What is that? Bhagavat pradhano. The speaker of Bhagavatam is one who has made Bhagavan Krishna as the prime objective of one's life. Means he is supposed to be a sincere devotee of Krishna. That is the qualification of speaker. Tanno bhavan vai bhagavat pradhano mahattam ikanta parayanasya. That Supreme Lord is the one and only shelter of all great devotees. And what is the quality of the subject matter that such a speaker describes? Harer udaram charitam vishuddham. So that is the descriptions of the wonderful narrations of Lord Hari. Udaram charitam vishuddham. Vishuddham means pure, uncontaminated. And udaram means extremely benevolent pastimes of Krishna. That's the quality of subject matter. And the quality of hearer is susrushatamno vitanotu vidvan. They are very eager to hear. So the quality of a speaker of Krishna Katha is Bhagavat Pradhana. Krishna is the prime object of his life. And hearer is susrushatam. Means he is very eager to hear. So eagerness on the part of hearer, devotion on the part of speaker, and the subject matter of Harikatha. That will make the conversations very exciting and relevant for multiple generations to come. All generations can hear. Now, when did Sukadeva Goswami and Parikshit Maharaj discuss? 5,000 years back. Till now, we are just discussing what Sukadeva Goswami spoke, what Parikshit Maharaj spoke. We are just still reading. That means it's not like a newspaper. Today we read and tomorrow it's gone. It's irrelevant. It's not some magazine. Okay, fortnightly magazine. So once you see the magazine and you read for a couple of days and it's gone. So it's not relevant anymore. As far as it is presenting material news. But spiritual literature is not like that. It's ever relevant. So now Parikshit Maharaj asked these questions about the pastimes of Krishna. And Sukadeva Goswami begins to describe Sudama's pastime. So Sukadeva Goswami says in the sixth shloka of this chapter, Sri Shuka Uvacha Krishnasya Sit Sakha Kaschit Brahmano Brahma Vittamaha Virakta Indriyartheshu Prasannatma Prashantatma Jitendriyaha. So in this shloka, Sukadeva Goswami describes six qualities of Sudama Brahman. He says, Krishnasya asit sakha kaschit. There used to be one friend of Krishna. Okay, sakha kaschit. There is one friend of Krishna. And who is that friend? Brahmano. He is a great Brahmana. Brahmavittamaha. He is not just Brahmana by birth. He is Brahmana by qualities. He is Brahmavittama. Means he understands the Vedic knowledge. He is well versed with the scriptures. Brahmavittama. Brahmano Brahmavittama. And the third quality, virakta indriyartheshu, means this Sudama Brahmana is virakta, he is very detached from any material enjoyment. He has no inclination to enjoy in a material plane. And prashantatma is very peaceful, unagitated, very sober person. Jitendriya, he conquered his senses. So these are the qualities of Sudama Brahmana. Now, seventh shloka. Sukadeva Goswami continues to describe the qualities of Sudama Brahman. He says, Yadrichayopapannena Vartamano Grihashrami Tasya Bharya Kuchailasya Kshukshama Chatathavidha. So, Yadrichayopapannena, this Sudama has this great quality to be happy with whatever comes of its own accord. He does not hanker for more and more material wealth. He does not crave for it, but whatever comes of its own accord by God's grace, by one's own honest efforts, he just accepts it and then lives like that. So he has no greed for material wealth. He has absolutely no greed. Although he has need, he has no greed. Sometimes we may genuinely have a need, but we should make sure that our need does not become greed. Okay, if we need this much, we may accumulate this much. So the difference is greed. From here to here, it is all greed. Okay, so we need to be satisfied with whatever is genuinely needed, genuinely necessary for our survival. Okay, so yadrichaya upapannena, Sudama is very satisfied with whatever comes of its own effort, and vartamano grahashrami, and is there in grahashrama, means grahasthashrama. Now the point is, as I said, that we should not be very greedy for material wealth. We should not be accumulating more than what is necessary for our maintenance. Sudama is actually not even doing that. Okay, he is too detached that he is emaciating himself. He is not eating. He does not have food to eat also properly. Yes, on one side you glorify his detachment. You glorify his renouncing spirit. You glorify his quality of not having greed. That's wonderful. But there's a problem with Sudama. There is something unwanted in Sudama. Okay. And in this whole pastime, we see that Krishna is going to purify Sudama of that one quality. What is that? He is too attached to his detachment. Right? He's detached, but he's too detached. He's too attached to his detachment. And because of too much of his attachment for his detachment, he has a slight tinge of pride. Somewhere within his heart, somewhere he's too proud that I'm so renounced. I don't need anything. I don't need any money. I'm not greedy for any money. So that kind of some little tinge of pride is there in him. And Krishna is going to give so much of wealth to Sudama and crush his pride. That's the pastime here. Okay. So in this attempt to purify Sudama from that slight tinge of pride that he has, Krishna is going to give us amazing life lessons, right, for all the devotees. Now you see, Bali Maharaj in the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So this Bali Maharaj was definitely a great devotee, exalted devotee of Krishna. Okay. And this Bali Maharaj was so charitable also. So now let's describe that scene where Bali Maharaj meets Vamanadeva. So Bali Maharaj is doing some sacrifice, and Vamanadeva comes to beg 3 steps of land from Bali. And Bali Maharaj says, "My dear child, you don't seem to be very intelligent. You don't seem to be having a proper understanding of how to lead life. 3 steps of land. I can give you that much of property with which you can live for 10 lifetimes. Right? You can live whole life so comfortably. But why are you asking only 3 steps of land? That too, you're a small child, right? So a small child is like a small boy, and how much his 3 steps would occupy? Bali Maharaj said, ask anything. Okay, I will give you. Then this boy gave a very long seminar on principles of satisfaction and said, just give me 3 steps, that's sufficient. Right? If I'm not satisfied with 3 steps of land, I won't be satisfied even if you give me 3 worlds. So let me just accept whatever I need only. So in this way, Bali Maharaj gave a deceptive seminar on principles of satisfaction and took only 3 steps of land. But you know what happened. So, and Vamanadeva occupied this whole universe within 2 steps only and asked Bali Maharaj, where is 3rd step? You promised to give me 3 steps and you're giving me only 2 steps. I'm arresting you. You will have to go to hell. So, on one hand, if you see in Bali Maharaj's pastime, Krishna has taken away everything from Bali. Okay. On the other hand, in Sudama's pastime, Krishna has given everything to Sudama, even if you did not ask for it. So in these 2 cases, Krishna's dealings with these 2 devotees seem to be opposite, completely opposite. He gave everything to him, although he doesn't need, he took everything from him, from Bali. But from a spiritual plane, Krishna is showing same kind of mercy upon both of his devotees. So Krishna removed the pride in Bali Maharaj by taking away everything. What was that pride? Bali Maharaj was thinking that I am a great charitable person, right? I have such great charitable disposition. I am a big data. So Krishna crushed that pride by proving that Bali could not even fulfill his promise. He gave a check that got bounced, right? He gave a check of the 3 steps of land. Take this check. And Bali Vamadeva went to encash that check, and he didn't have sufficient bank balance. In 2 steps only, the check got bounced. So now Vamadeva crushed the pride, little pride only, not so much. Okay. Crushed the tinge of pride that Bali Maharaj had by taking away everything. And Krishna gave everything to Sudama and crushed his pride of being renounced, so renounced. So we need to be extremely careful. Sometimes even our good qualities also could increase some pride in us. We need to be extremely careful. So Sudama was so renounced that he is not even having sufficient food to eat, right? And he's attached to the detachment. Okay. So, but his wife, such a glorious lady, she could not tolerate this pain of seeing her husband suffer like that. So now Sudama's chaste wife went to Sudama and said, let's recite the shloka, 8th shloka. Pativrata patim praha mlayata vadane nasam daridram sidamana vai vepamana bhigam yacham. So Sudama was suffering like this, and Sudama's wife went to Sudama and said, my dear husband, she also had some fear in her heart, right? She was a little hesitant. One is respectful fear, okay, that's fine, some kind of reverence. But second is, she is also detecting that my husband may not agree to my proposal. Actually, she went to Sudama with a proposal. And what was the proposal? She was about to ask Sudama that, my dear friend, my dear husband, please go to your friend Krishna and beg some charity. That Sudama is not agreeable to it. And she can anticipate that. But her emotions are so deep that she could not control her emotions. She felt that, how can I see my husband suffer from hunger like this? It's not that Sudama's wife, she's a great devotee, definitely. It's not that Sudama's wife had some greed for wealth. One should not misunderstand Sudama's wife that, oh, Sudama was so renounced that he was hesitating to go to Krishna to ask for wealth. But his wife pressurized him, pushed him. Yes, she pressurized him. She pushed him. She followed up so much with him. But not out of a greed for material wealth, out of love for husband. So Sudama's wife did not have a mood to enjoy on a material plane. She was not desiring sense gratification. She was only desiring that my husband should not suffer so much of poverty. And my husband is a great devotee of Krishna. How can a devotee of Krishna struggle to even eat some food on a daily basis? He does not have even little food to eat. So Krishna's devotee should not suffer like this. So out of love for husband, out of devotion to Krishna only, Sudama's wife came to Sudama with a proposal, but she was a little hesitant, little fearful that Sudama may not agree to her proposal. Okay, let's see. Sudama's wife is saying. So she said that actually she cooks and feeds her husband. But they have become so poor that she did not have enough grains to feed her husband also. How long they will fast? Okay, in that circumstances she came and told. Not that she has some greed for money. 9th shloka. Nanu Brahman Bhagavataham Sakshat Sakha Sakshat Shri Ahapatihim Brahman Yascha Charanyascha Bhagavan Satvatarshabha. So our Sudama's wife is saying, Nanu Brahman Bhagavataha, my dear husband, you have a great friend, Krishna, and that Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead. Means Sudama's wife is aware of the divinity of Krishna, about the godhood of Krishna. Krishna is the Supreme Lord. This is known to Sudama's wife, and she is also a devotee. Okay. And Sakha, and that Supreme Lord, Krishna, is your friend. Sakha, And Sakshat Shri Yahapatihi, he is not only your friend, he is a very wealthy friend. He is Shri Yahapatihi, he is the husband of Lakshmi Devi, he is the husband of Goddess of Fortune, he is the husband of Rukmini Devi. So you are not meant to suffer like this when you have such a great friend. That's an insult to your friend. So Brahmanyascha Charanyascha. Now Sudama might say, okay, he may be Lakshmipati, he may be Shri Yahapatihi, but why should he give me any wealth? Sudama's wife says, Krishna is Brahmanya. He is very dear to Brahmanas and he is very kind and compassionate towards all the Brahmanas. So Brahmanyascha Charanyascha, whoever takes shelter of Krishna will receive all benedictions and all assistance from Krishna. Okay. Bhagavan Sattvatarshabha, he is Bhagavan, he is the possessor of all opulences, and he is Sattvatarshabha, he is the lord of all Sattvata devotees. Okay. So please go and request some help, ask some money. And she says in the 10th sloka, Tamupaihi Mahabhaga Sadhunam Chaparayanam Dasyati Dravinam Bhuri. So tam upaiti mahabhaga, oh greatly fortunate Sudama, he is sadhunam cha parayanam. So he is the real object of shelter of all sadhus. And you are a sadhu. Sadhu is not just a person who shaves his head and then wears a saffron dress. Any person who is honestly performing his prescribed duties, whether he's in householder life or a vanaprastha life or sannyas life or brahmachari life, so they are all called sadhus. Sadhu is a good person, okay, who is a very dutiful person. So dasyati dravinam bhuri, he will definitely give you dravina, means money. He will give you as much money as you want because he is very kind to all his devotees. So please go and ask him. Please don't hesitate. So then she says, in the 11th shloka, she says that aste adhuna dvaravatyam, and we know that he is in Dwaravatipura. Dwaravati means Dwaraka, right? So right now he is staying in Dwaraka. Okay. And Bhoja Vrishni Andhakeshwaraha, and he is also acting as the master of all Bhojas, Vrishnis and Andhakas in the Dwaraka Dham. And Smarantaha Pada Kamalam Atmanam Abhiyachati. So Smarata, very, very beautiful statement that she has made. That shows her devotional qualities, Sudama's wife's devotional qualities. She said, Smarantaha Pada Kamalam Atmanam Apiyachati. If you do Smaran, if you remember Krishna, Krishna's lotus feet, Smarantaha Pada Kamalam Atmanam Apiyachati, he can even give his own self to you. Right? He is such a bhakta vatsala, vatsalata he has, that he can give his own self to all his devotees. So please, go and beg some wealth from Krishna. Okay. And as I said, she's not greedy for wealth. She's only desirous that her husband should not suffer so much. Okay. Now you see, Sudama finally agreed. So the selflessness and detached spirit of Sudama is seen in this pastime from beginning till end. He was not having any expectations from Krishna. Sudama's wife was not greedy for material wealth. She told her husband to go to Krishna only so that he doesn't suffer out of hunger. And Sudama went to Krishna not for greed, not for accumulating material wealth, just to satisfy his wife. Okay. So wife loves husband so much. Husband loves wife so much. And that's the reason Sudama went to Krishna. Okay, and both wife and husband love Krishna so much. So now you see their love is centered on Krishna, not centered on material wealth. And somehow that wealth, that some little money that they needed, brought them much closer to Krishna. Okay, and purified Sudama of that slight tinge of pride that he had for material wealth, slight tinge of pride that he had about his renunciation, right? So we should see the selfless spirit of both these devotees. Then Sudama starts preparing to go. So in the 12th and 13th sloka, Sukadeva Goswami says, Sa evam bharyaya vipro bahushaha prarthito muhu. Bharya, this wife, of Sudama just begged Sudama several times, right? Bahushaha prarthito muhu. Muhu means constantly, repeatedly she is following up. Please go, please go, please go. Every day she is probably pushing him so much, right? So then finally he said, okay, fine, I'll go. And what with what intention he went? Ayam hi paramo labha uttama shloka darshanam. So I will get parama labha. Parama labha means greatest benefit, not money. Uttama shloka darshanam, the darshan of Krishna. So let me have darshan of Krishna, and that is the greatest benefit. So I am not going to Krishna, to Dwaraka, to get some wealth from Krishna. I am going to Dwaraka to see Krishna's darshan. So with that intention, Sudama started for Dwaraka. But before starting, Sudama said, I am going to meet Krishna for a long time. Do we have anything at home so that I can offer some gift to Krishna? Right? Sudama asked his wife. And his wife was very embarrassed. She did not have anything. Such a glorious lady, devoted lady she was. So she immediately went outside her house. And in a torn cloth, she just took a torn cloth and begged some poha, some flat rice from few neighbor's houses. And she is a Brahmana, a Brahmani lady. But she begged rice from people of different varnas, right? So now you see, to offer something that one has is an easy thing. To go out of one's way to get something and then offer it to the Lord, that takes little extra effort. And Sudama and Sudama's wife did that, right? So then yachitva chaturo mushtim vipran pruthukatandulan. So she somehow managed to get four handfuls of flat rice. Just four handfuls of flat rice she got. And pruthukatandulan means this flat rice. And then she tied them in a piece of cloth and then gave it to Sudama. And Sudama went. Okay, so taking this flat rice, so he went and he was thinking, Krishna sandarshanam mahiyam katham syad iti chintayan. Within the mind, Sudama was thinking while traveling, how do I meet Krishna? When I go to Dwaraka, I will have to meet Krishna. Is it possible? Sudama was quite doubtful. Why he was doubtful? Because he thought, look, I am looking like this in a very, very poor situation. I look like a beggar and avadhut. Will I be allowed inside Dwaraka? Maybe the doorkeeper's angels will stop me. They may block my path. They may not even allow me to enter only. So he was doubtful even to enter, right? But he got such a royal reception. Let's see. So one thing is, he is anticipating. He's quite excited. Sudama is quite excited to visit Krishna. But Sudama had some doubts whether he will be allowed in Dwaraka or not. So now you see, when we are going to meet Krishna, when we are going to temple or some yatra, so to the degree we are excited, to the degree we are enthusiastic to see Dham, to see the darshan of the Lord, to that degree, our pilgrimage will be successful. Right? So Krishna reciprocates with our enthusiasm. Rupa Goswami says in Upadeshamrita, he says that, Utsaha, Nishchaya, Dhairya, Tattat, Karma, Bhavartana. So Utsaha, enthusiasm is a very important quality. So Sudama is definitely enthusiastic, and his enthusiasm is associated with his humility. So Sudama was not thinking that, of course, I'm a friend of Krishna. I'm a childhood friend of Krishna. We both studied together in our college, in our school. And definitely he will meet me. Of course, it's his responsibility. If he doesn't meet me, I will chastise him. So friends have that kind of relationship. But Sudama, out of his humility, was not expecting. He was not thinking that I am qualified for Krishna's darshan. I am qualified for Krishna's reciprocation. I deserve it. He did not have that mentality. Sudama was totally humble. He has absolutely no demand from Krishna. He had only devotion for Krishna. Because he did not have any demand, he did not aggressively expect something from Krishna, he became grateful for everything that he received when he met Krishna. It's a very important point to note. when we have expectations in the mind, and when those expectations are not fulfilled, which is often the case, we become frustrated. When we don't have expectations in the mind, and unexpectedly we receive some favors or some reciprocation, we become grateful. So it's up to us whether we have expectations and get frustrated, or whether we give up expectations and become grateful. So gratitude is that quality which brings us closer to Krishna. So having undue expectations and demands, even from the Lord or devotees, so that's not very much appreciated in Vaishnava circles. The point is that after spending few years in devotional service, an average sadhaka has certain expectations and a sense of entitlement. I deserve these facilities, these comforts. I deserve this kind of reciprocation. I deserve to have this honor. Although our philosophy or sampradaya says that trinadapi sunichena tarorapi sahishnuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadaharihi. So amanina manadena, don't expect any respect and offer all respect. Although this is what we are taught, but subtly somewhere deep within the heart, there is an expectation of respect. There is a hankering, okay, in an average conditioned soul or even a struggling sadhaka. Okay, so there is a hankering for honor. Now this Indra's worship was stopped by Krishna. Okay, so why did Krishna stop Indra puja and then begin Govardhan puja? Because Indra had pride. So when Indra's worship was stopped, Indra became so angry, because he was hankering for that honor. I need to be worshipped. They have to perform the sacrifice to please me, to worship me. Otherwise, I will take revenge upon them. I will just destroy this entire Vrindavan. So this Indra had this hankering for honor. He was expecting that respect. So when we have no expectations on the material plane, and when we don't even expect something from the Lord also, okay, then whatever the Lord gives, we become grateful. But when we have expectations, whatever we may get, we may not value it. We may not become excited with the reciprocation that we receive, right? So now Sudama did not have that expectations, as we will see in the past time as it unfolds. So with great expectation, with great anticipation to see Krishna, he was only thinking that if I get to see Krishna, that is sufficient for me. That's all I want. I don't want anything else from him. Okay. But do I deserve to see Krishna? Will I be allowed inside? Maybe the soldiers may block my entrance. So he was thinking that. Somehow he joined some local brahmanas. He traveled all the way to Dwaraka. And on the way to Dwaraka, he's so happy. And even Akrura, Akrura was sent by Kamsa to Vrindavan to bring Krishna and Balram to Mathura. Okay. So at that time, Akrura was also anticipating on his way to Vrindavan. Akrura was thinking, I'm so fortunate to be able to see Krishna today. I'm going to meet Krishna. So he was not thinking that I deserve Krishna. I deserve to see Krishna. He was only thinking that what great austerities have I done? Okay. What great tapasya did I perform? Today, I got the opportunity to go to Vrindavan and see Krishna in Vrindavan. And he became grateful even to Kamsa also. Kamsa has done a great favor to me by sending me with a new chariot to bring Krishna and Balram. What does it mean? Kamsa is so kind to me. So he is being grateful to the instrument of his fortune. Right? So anyways, Sudama went forward. And when Sudama went to Dwaraka, nobody stopped him. Of course, Krishna is Brahmanya Deva. And all his servants also align with the mood of Krishna. They don't stop a Brahmana. They don't say, hey, who is this beggar coming inside our house? Will anyone allow, right, a beggar to come inside the house? But Sudama had 100 knots on his dhoti. He does not have proper cloth. And he does not have proper flesh on his body. Also, he has the ribcage. Right? All these bones are visible. Right? So, but he was allowed. He went there. There are 16,000 Varnatid palaces. Where to go? Right? So where will he go? Where is Krishna? In such a huge, city of Dwaraka, where it's called Kushasthali Dvipa. On this Kushasthali Dvipa, on this huge city of Dwaraka, just Krishna's family members are like in lakhs. Krishna had 16,000 108 queens, and each queen had 10 sons and one daughter. So like that, Krishna's family is so huge. And what to speak of Balramji and so many other Yadus and Vrishnis and Bhojas and Dakas. So all these people are like so many. And where will Krishna stay? And okay, fine, 16,108 palaces of Krishna are there. Which palace he should go? In which palace Krishna would be there? But interestingly, in whichever palace Sudama would go, Krishna would be there. Because it's not that one Krishna is living in Dwaraka. Krishna expands himself into 16,108 forms and stays in all the 16,108 palaces of his 16,108 queens. Okay. In whichever palace Sudama enters, he can see Krishna. There is good probability. Okay. So what is the possibility? Point one, point two, point three, right? So we don't have to calculate. It's 100% possibility of seeing Krishna in whichever palace he enters. So he just randomly entered one palace. And that palace happened to be Rukmini's palace. And Krishna was sitting on the bed of Rukmini Devi, right, on the couch of Rukmini Devi. And Rukmini was doing so many services to Krishna. So at that time, Sudama went to meet Krishna. So as soon as Krishna saw Sudama, Krishna became so excited, so happy. So Krishna got up from his seat. Now, to get up from the seat, when you're sitting and somebody comes there and immediately get up, that shows great respect. That shows that you value that person's presence there. You are acknowledging that person's presence. It means something to you that when he comes there. But if you are sitting there and people are just passing by, okay, you're not even verbally greeting, that means it doesn't mean anything to you when people are coming. So now, not getting up from one seat when a respectable person comes there, it shows some kind of pride and arrogance or lack of love. Okay. But Krishna loved Sudama so much, he just got up from his seat. Now, just one chapter before this current section, we see a proud and arrogant person being punished profusely by the Lord for not getting up from his seat. And that was Romaharshana Sutta. Romaharshana Sutta was sitting in his seat, addressing so many Brahmanas. And Balaramji came there. When Balaram came there, Romaharshana did not have the etiquette of getting up and honoring Balaramji. So Balaramji took a blade of grass and killed Romaharshana. He did not take blade, he took blade of grass. And he just killed Romaharshana within a moment. He's omnipotent. He can empower even blade of grass also with the ability to kill a person. How can grass kill a person? But Balaramji can do it. Because he showed pride. He showed some arrogance. He showed disrespect, contempt. But Krishna was so respectful to the Brahmanas. He got up from his seat as soon as he saw Sudama. So now, Krishna's receiving of Brahmanas, Krishna's reception and Krishna's respecting Brahmanas is very much seen at several places in Srimad Bhagavatam. And one such episode is in the previous chapters, where Rukmini Devi's messenger comes to Krishna to meet him in Dwaraka. Because before the marriage of Rukmini Devi to Krishna, Rukmini sends a letter, okay, through a Brahmana. And the Brahmana comes all the way from Kundinapur to Dwaraka to read this letter to Krishna. At that time, Krishna just got up from his seat and then received this Brahmana with all respect and then washed his feet and treated him very respectfully. So similar thing he's doing to Sudama, but in Sudama's case, it's like one step extra. There he's a regular Brahmana, Rukmini's messenger. But in Sudama's case, he is a Brahmana also, he's Krishna's childhood friend also. Right? The childhood friendship has a very deep, intimate bonding. So Krishna just got up, oh, my dear friend has come. He just got up and Krishna made Sudama sit on the couch on which he was sitting. And Krishna sat down. Okay, although he is Bhagavan Lokapavanaha, Krishna can purify all the planetary systems, all the planets. But Krishna started washing the feet of Sudama. And Krishna treated Sudama as if Sudama were his elder brother. So just as Krishna honors Balaramji, Krishna was honoring Sudama also. Because he's elder brother, right? So he is Brahmanya Deva. And Krishna started washing the feet. You see this book? So Krishna is washing the feet of Sudama. And Krishna had tears in his eyes. And because her husband is doing so much of intimate and menial service to Sudama, Rukmini also got that arati paraphernalia, and she also started offering chamar to Sudama, chamar and vision. Okay. So now you see such a warm reception of this Brahmana, Sudama. Now, Krishna is not just giving a formal respect. It's not just etiquette. It's emotion. Now, to get up from the seat when a Brahmana comes is etiquette. To wash his feet, to offer arghya, padya, and various other worship paraphernalia, that is also part of etiquette. It's a culture. So Krishna is not just showing some culture. Krishna's behavior is not just cultural, or it's according to some etiquette of respecting Brahmanas, or it's not according to the duties of a Kshatriya or duties of householder. In this case, Krishna is not just acting like a Kshatriya or a householder, or he is not just treating a Brahmana in a formal manner, but he has emotions, he has love. So you may get up from your seat if you follow etiquette and culture, but you will not have tears in your eyes unless you have emotions, unless you have love. While washing the feet of Sudama, why Krishna had to have tears in his eyes? That means he loved Sudama so much. So where is this love of Krishna coming? Because Sudama had love for Krishna. So Krishna's love is in reciprocation with our love for him. Yeyadhamam prapadyante tamstathaiva bhajamyaham. Krishna may honor so many brahmanas, but Krishna's way of honoring this brahmana is quite special. He had tears in his eyes. That he's showing some devotion, he's showing some affection, he's getting emotionally overwhelmed. That's because of his friendship, and that's in reciprocation with the love of Sudama. So the love between, now we see the situation of Sudama. Kuchai lammali nam kshamam dvijam dhamani santatam, 23rd shloka. Devi paryacharat sakshat chamaravyajanena vai. So kuchai lammali nam kshamam, kuchela. He's malinam, he's very dirty. He traveled for a long time and his clothes are very dirty. So now you wear this cloth, you know, for, you know, 10 years or 20 years, it becomes very dirty and it's not presentable. And there's so many knots on his cloth. Malinam kshamam. Kshamam is very emaciated, very poor, poverty stricken. Dvijam dhamani santatam. And his bones are seen. All his ribcage and their impressions are just coming out, right? And the skin is just like a small thin layer of some bed sheet on his body. It does not have enough flesh. It doesn't have enough thickness, right? And Devi Parichara Sakshat, but Krishna is worshipping this Sudama so much. So Devi, his queen Rukmini, also started worshipping Sudama. Right? Chamara Vyajanena Vai, with Chamara and Vyajan. So seeing this, Antaha Purajano Drishtva Krishne Namala Kirtina Vismito Bhut Ati Pritya Avadhutam Sabhajitam. So Antahpura Jana, all the people in Antahpura, Antahpura means the palace, they're astonished, they were surprised. My God, why our Krishna, our Supreme Lord Krishna, is just worshipping this Brahmana with so much of emotion and respect? Who is he? Who is this special soul? They were all surprised. Generally, rich people do not like to identify themselves with poor people. Okay. Rich person, an influential person, or a king, or a ruler in the royal order. So he does not generally want to say that, oh, this poor beggar is my friend. People don't love to do it. And best example we can see in Drupada and Drona. Okay. Drupada and Drona were also childhood friends. They both studied in Gurukul. One is Kshatriya. Drupada was a Kshatriya. And Dronacharya was a Brahmana. So, and they grew up. So they departed from their Gurukul. And Dronacharya was having some tough time maintaining his family and even to feed his child. So he came to take some help from Drupada. Drupada Maharaj said, "Who are you? I don't know. How can you be my friend? I'm a king. You look like a beggar Brahmana. How can we both be friends? Why do you?" I mean, he kind of insulted. So, and that started a lot of dispute and all. You know the story. But point is, rich people, very rich people, and proud rich people, not all rich people. So people who take pride in their wealth, people who take pride in their position or designation, material designation, they don't like to say that, oh, we are acquainted with so and so poor person. Even sometimes children also, when they go to school, for example, they have very poor parents. So all the classmates in the of the children, so they say they may be coming from some wealthy families or rich families or like well-settled parents they may be having. Sometimes children also feel a little ashamed. Oh, my father is a rickshawala. My father is a sweeper. So in that kind of a sense of social prestige is there even in children also, even in childhood also, right? So that's the nature of Maya, right? So one might feel even ashamed to claim that, okay, we are living in a poor house. Although it is a fact, our parents are poor. So now here the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is the husband of Goddess of Fortune, he is openly, publicly showing his acquaintance with this poor Brahmana without any hesitation. So all that matters to Krishna is our love, not our material designation or position, right? Naham viprona chandrapatir napavaishyona sudro. So Krishna does not see what you are Brahmana or a Kshatriya or a Vaishya or a Shudra or a poor man or a rich man or Indian or American. He does not even see whether you are a human being or non-human being. Right? He has devotees in all species. Right? So to this degree, Krishna is broad-minded in reciprocating with his devotees. He is liberal. So how exactly he reciprocated, what are the actions that happened, we will see tomorrow. It's 8:29 now. I would like to stop here. Anyone has any questions, you can just ask. I was thinking of stopping at 20 only, but somehow I just went forward. Sorry.
Thank you so much for such a Nectarian narration of the Katha till now. We are eagerly looking forward to the lessons we can get, we can capture from tomorrow and what is going to unfold. Many nice points that we registered. I do not know if anyone has a question, because we have to be mindful of Prabhuji's time also. Maybe if someone has a ready-made question on top of the mind, we can take one question. We forgot to mention that in the beginning of the class. Anybody would like to ask a question which is relevant to the pastime? And okay, so I'll just unmute Subhadra Mataji. Yes, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu, Dhanvat Pranam. Thank you for your wonderful narration, Prabhu. Krishna was in Sandipani Muni's ashram only for 64 days. So within that time, Sudama and Krishna had developed so much of love, or how to understand this?
64 days, Krishna can develop his deep relationship in 64 minutes also. And we by default, we all have such eternal friendship and love for Krishna. And those who are developed in their consciousness, it's so natural. In the very first meeting, in the first moment of their meeting, Hanumanji and Ram, their mutual love for each other is like invoked. And like that, several devotees of Krishna, so they can immediately connect with Krishna because of their natural love for him. When the consciousness is pure, immediately there is a connection established in the first sight itself. It doesn't, like 64 days is such a long time, actually speaking. You must be having enough intimate experience. Anyone else?
Prabhuji, there is this question. I mean, is it really wrong to approach Krishna with expectations? Because it is possible that that is where we are right now. So that could be our... Yeah.
So Bhagavatam says, akamaha sarva kamo va moksha kama udaradhihi tivrena bhakti yogena yajeta purushah param akamaha. Whether we have no desires, sarva kamova, whether we have all kinds of desires, moksha kama, whether we are specifically desiring liberation, we can do bhakti yoga, we can approach Krishna. However, that is not the best. So, ideally, a devotee renders service to Krishna, approaches Krishna selflessly, without any material expectations. But because in the initial stages, even if someone happens to have some expectations, even on a material plane, that's fine. Dhruva approached the Lord with a material expectation, with an ambition to become greater than Brahma, higher position than Brahma, he wanted to attain. And Gajendra surrendered to the Lord just to protect himself from crocodile in the beginning. But that Sakama Bhakti states, Sakama Bhakti means doing bhakti with an expectation of some kind of benediction, some kind of material from the Lord. So that Sakama Bhakti is only a phase. Okay. Within no time, that Sakama Bhakta can become Nishkama Bhakta. And that within no time, as you said, it could take a few years or few decades or a couple of lifetimes also. But on the scale of eternity, this little bit of time is actually little bit only. Okay, even if it takes a couple of lifetimes for a Sakama Bhakta to become Nishkama Bhakta. For Dhruva Maharaj, it took 6 months. Okay. For us, it may take maybe 6 years or 6 decades or 6 lifetimes. We don't know. But once we keep ourselves in Krishna's shelter, even with motivations in the beginning, Krishna will remove those motivations and retain our bhakti. We may be doing sakama bhakti, Krishna will remove sakama and keep only bhakti. He will preserve bhakti. He will remove all the suffixes and prefixes and keep the substance there, bhakti. Okay. So Krishna will take care. But we don't have to hesitate. Oh, I have this desire, can I surrender to Krishna? Hey, no problem. You can come. You can approach Krishna in any circumstances. Right? Kama, dvesha, bhaya, sneha. Krishna is kind enough to purify people who approach him even with negative emotions of dvesha also. Of course, that's not a recommendation. But Krishna can purify even Shishupala also, Kamsa also, because they connected with Krishna with negative emotions. But somehow their negative emotions made them absorb in Krishna, in constant remembrance of Krishna. That's why they are purified. But caution note is, if our negative emotions towards Krishna fall short of Kamsa's negative emotions or Hiranyakashipu's negative emotions, we may have to go to hell. So that's why negative emotions are not recommendations, but we can only appreciate Krishna's mercy. If someone connects to Krishna, even with negative emotions, he's so kind. Okay. Make sense, Prabhu?
Yes, yes.
And we just entered the pastime, so much more excitement is there in the middle section. Yeah. The remembrances, memories of Krishna. So that we'll do tomorrow and after. That's more exciting part of the pastime. Thank you.
Excellent project. Hare Krishna.
Atra Shrimad Bhagavatam Pijaya Shrila Prabhupada Pijaya.